Get this done. We've got a big game tonight to watch.
This is a big game. Hopefully we win.
Or at least prevent Washington from getting the President's Trophy.
Yeah. It's either going to be them or Pittsburgh, right?
Well, it's pretty much going to be them. All they need is 1 point, I think, tonight. All right. You ready?
Ready to go.
All right. We're actually starting on time this week, almost. Hello and welcome to the next episode of the Hockey Nuts Podcast. I believe it's episode 34. My name is Wayne. I'm here with Steve. Wouldn't you agree, Steve?
I agree. Great evening to talk to you, Wayne, and talk hockey. I'm looking forward to tonight very, very much.
Oh, we've got a ton to talk about tonight. Just to lay it all out there, just to tell you what we've got on our minds this week. Of course, we've got the playoff races, which are actually almost over. There's only a couple spots left to claim in the playoffs, and we'll get you caught up on everything that's happened over the past week in the playoff races. Brian Bickell made his long-awaited return to the ice last night for the Carolina Hurricanes, and of course we'll tell you why that's big news. The NHL made a big announcement over the past week concerning the Olympics, and we have all the details of that. We have more junior and college players that are joining the pro ranks. We'll get you caught up on all those signings. And the NCAA hockey tournament's down to the last four teams, and that gets going actually tomorrow night, so we'll get you caught up on everything going on there. And then last but not least, we had our day with the NHL Centennial Fan Arena, and I can tell you just right off the top, we had a blast, and we'll get you stay tuned to the end of the show. We'll get you caught up on everything that happened there. And boy, if we got some stories to tell.
Great day, by the way. Yep. It was a great day.
We had a lot of fun. But before we do all that, let's go ahead and, as usual, get everybody caught up on what's been going on with our favorite teams over the past week. And yes. I want to start with the Bruins this week because they had the best week of all the teams that we've been following. Bruins had a perfect 4-0 week, and they are white hot right now, which I'm thrilled about because you couldn't have it happen at a better time of the year. Going back to the beginning of the week, the Bruins got a 2-0 win against Dallas on the 30th, and then they got a 5-2 win against Florida on the 1st. A 3-2 win at Chicago on the 2nd, which was their last road game of the year. And then they got a 4-0 win at Tampa on the 4th. And that was the night that the Bruins clinched the playoffs. So, Bruins will be back in the playoffs for the first time in 3 years.
There you go.
I couldn't be happier about it.
I bet you are. I've been telling you all year.
I know you have.
All year to have the faith, to keep the faith. And they finally pulled it off. So I'm happy for you, Wayne. And, the Bruins deserve to be in the playoffs.
The way they played over the last month. Yeah, they absolutely do.
They're a playoff team. They played well all year for the most part. And, I just think that I don't know what they'll do in the playoffs, but they deserve to be there. They're one of the easily one of the four best teams in the Atlantic, maybe one of the three or two best teams in that division.
Yep.
And I'm happy for them, and as I said, they earned it, but they deserve it. It's not like you don't see a lot of bad teams back into the playoffs, but occasionally you do. And the Bruins are certainly not one of them.
Yeah, this day and age where there's 30 teams in the league, you're hard-pressed to find a team that is a quote-unquote bad team and making it to the playoffs. Not like it was back in the days when there were 21 teams and 16 made it. There were bad teams that made the playoffs every year.
Oh, yeah.
And they usually, the first-round games were four-game sweeps. But now where it's 30 teams and in the East it's even harder – because 16 of the teams are in the East, so only 8 of those make the playoffs. So right. Only half the teams make the playoffs in the East. In the West, it's a little bit easier because you've only got 14 teams and 8 of them make it. So, it's an accomplishment to get there. It really is. And you could see it in the players' reactions at the end of the game. The celebration at the end of that game and against Tampa was a little bit more enthusiastic than just a typical win. The
right.
Bruins were really celebrating that one. So.
Yeah.
Yep. I'm very happy to be back on the road, and I'm going to be a nervous wreck now during the playoffs game.
I think Wayne, okay, I take it a step further. I think you're going to be playing the 2-3 matchup.
I hope so. I'm trying. Yeah. I'm hoping that they can get out of that 8th seed, and end up not having to play through the Metropolitan Division, because, man, what a that side of the bracket is going to be that very difficult to get through. I mean, with Columbus, Pittsburgh, and Washington in that other side of the bracket, any team that has to play with that group of three is got their hands full for sure.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I agree.
But if the Bruins win out, and of course that's no easy feat. They've got Ottawa and Washington to finish out the season, but hopefully Washington will sit Holtby and Ovechkin and a couple of those guys, and at least give the Bruins a chance to beat them on the last weekend of the season. But the Ottawa game, I certainly think they can win. Although I'm not sure we're going to have Brad Marchand for that game. We'll get to that. If the Bruins can eke out at least one more win or two or three more points, they should avoid that 8th spot pretty easily. So, all right. Well, let's talk about the Rangers now.
Well, we had a tough loss. It's a game I did not watch. I had company come in town on that Friday night, so I did not see any of that game. But my understanding of that game was it was a very tough loss that the Rangers played well against Pittsburgh that night and lost. I saw the goal that Sidney Crosby scored on Henrik bouncing off his back.
Yeah, that was ridiculous.
He's very adept with the puck, and he's a sniper. So what can you say? I know Henrik didn't like it.
No, he wasn't too happy with that one.
Yeah, but Sidney actually plays Henrik pretty darn well. And I've heard him say on more than one occasion that he thinks that Crosby is the best player in the league. So that's a guy I would take his word for it. But anyways, we came back, and although there was a scare there at the end, we beat Philadelphia 4-3 and kicked them out of the playoffs. And that win for me was sweet justice, extremely sweet justice, because real quickly, back in 2010, if you'll recall, it came down to the last game of the season, and there was one playoff spot available and two teams fighting for it, and that was us and the Philadelphia Flyers. And it just so happened we were playing the Flyers that day. So the winner of that game got into the Stanley Cup playoffs, and the loser sat at home. And we lost that game in a shootout in Philadelphia.
I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, I still to this day did not feel good about that at all, and I didn't think Philadelphia deserved to be in the playoffs or win that game, but it didn't really matter. They made it, and so the win that we had against them a couple of nights ago was extra special. I was very happy about that. And then, of course, we played tonight against the Capitals, and in a game where they will not be sitting Braden Holtby and Alex Ovechkin and all their major players. They're certainly going to try to win this game and get that President's Trophy again. Although I think that's a Colombian necktie.
Yep. They can have it.
Yeah, they can have it. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I saw somewhere the last team to win the President's Trophy and win the Cup was, I can't remember now who it was, but it's been years. 2007, yep. I think.
Yeah.
Was the last year that the President's Trophy won Stanley Cup, and I can't even remember what team it was, but
might have been Detroit.
It's possible. Yeah. Either way, it's been a while, and it doesn't happen often. Even before that, it had been years before that. So, yeah, it's bit kind of known as a bit of a curse to have the President's Trophy going into the playoffs. So, yeah. So, yeah, I'm totally okay with Washington having it.
Yes, I agree.
All right. Well, yeah, Rangers did have a kind of a quiet week. They only had a couple of games since we last recorded. So, right. But Carolina Hurricanes they were doing well there for a while. They had a 13-game point streak going, and we were talking about it on the last episode. And after that, they won one more game. They had a 2-1 overtime win against Columbus on the 30th. But then they went to, or they had a home game against Dallas. Going into that game, they were still only 4 points out with, I think, 5 to play. They still had a legitimate shot of catching and getting into that 8th seed. But that Dallas game ended up being a major nail in their coffin. They ended up taking a 3-0 loss at home. I went to that game. My son and I went to that game. And I could tell you, the atmosphere in the building was great throughout most of the game. At the beginning, of course, it was. But the game essentially, the score was 3-0, but essentially it was a 1-0 game because there were two empty net goals there. Throughout that game, there were moments where the crowd was almost being lulled to sleep because the game was 1-0, or it was 0-0 for a long, long time, and then Dallas got a goal that, in my opinion, Cam Ward should have had. He just didn't come out far enough to cut down the angle on the shot, and so ended up being 1-0 all the way to the end. And then right at the end of the game, Carolina pulled their goalie to try to get the equalizer, and the crowd was into it. When it got into the last 5 minutes of the game, the crowd woke up again and really, really was pushing for the Hurricanes. And of course, being Dallas in town, there weren't a lot of Dallas fans there. Dallas is not one of those teams that travels well,
right?
Like some of the other teams that come into Carolina. And so the crowd was very, very pro Carolina in that game. And, you know, they were into it, and they were supporting the team, cheering, you know, let's go Canes, all the cheers that you hear when you're in that building. And it was not a sellout crowd, but that's obviously understandable because at that same time that game was going on, North Carolina Tar Heels were playing in the national semifinal game, which is going to draw better interest, quite frankly, in this area. So, but it was a decent crowd considering the fact that North Carolina was playing in the national semifinal game in college basketball. So, but it was a very loud crowd. They were passionate. They were there. You know, people were there, wanted to be there. And as soon as Dallas got that second goal, you could just feel the disappointment in the whole crowd, the air come out of the building. And I felt so bad for the fans that were there because I really wanted Carolina, even though it probably would have made things tighter for the Bruins. I really wanted Carolina to get that equalizer and come back and win, or at least get a point, if not two, out of that game, and keep that streak going and keep their chances going of squeaking in the playoffs. Because it's been so long since they've had a playoff season here, and I think the fans really deserve it at this point. But
I agree. I wanted to say real quick, Wayne.
Yeah.
You and I, you know, we talked about the Hurricanes and their season last year, and they stayed in the running for the playoffs all the way up, very close to the end.
Yep.
This year, I think they stayed in it a little longer.
They got even closer. Yep.
But this year's team is much better. It is much improved. They should take heart in the fact that next year, if I'm sitting down making predictions on teams that should make the playoffs, Carolina would definitely be one of them. They are.
Yep.
I think their goaltending situation needs to be tweaked, but they definitely are a team that should make the playoffs next year.
Yeah.
And I didn't say that at the beginning of this year, but they've definitely risen the ladder. so to speak.
Now, I think in our early shows, I went out there and said that Carolina, I went way out on a limb and said Carolina is going to make the playoffs this year. And at the very least, they're going to be close.
Yeah.
And we were right about that. We certainly were.
We were.
You know, they fell just short of the playoffs, but I can definitely say next year, assuming they can avoid that slow start that they have every year, they're going to be in it right to
the end.
Yeah, I agree. And I think they're going to probably squeak in next year.
Yep.
I think next year is finally going to be the year because all these new prospects that they've got are going to be a year older. I'm not sure their goaltending situation is going to be solved. I just, you know, I'm with you on the goaltending. I just don't think that Eddie Lack and Cam Ward, that either one of them are bona fide number one guys that you can put your franchise on.
Right.
Cam Ward, his best days are behind him. Eddie Lack has shown, little spurts of it here and there, but he hasn't shown it on a consistent basis. And he, quite frankly, has a lot of injury issues that seem to crop up from time to time, which makes it so that to make him a full-time goalie that's going to, do you 60 games a year is just, I don't see him doing it. So they do have some goaltending prospects in the system. I'm not sure any of them are going to be ready yet. Nedeljkovic has been the one that's probably shown the most promise thus far, but they've got a couple other guys that are even younger that have yet to been given a shot. So we'll see. We'll see, I guess, probably as rookie camp comes along in the summertime and then later on as you head into training camp, see if any of these goaltenders can step up and challenge either Lack or Ward for a job next year. Mm-hmm. And I don't see, obviously, one of those two guys is going to be left unprotected in the expansion draft, and I just don't see, I don't see the Vegas Golden Knights taking one of those two goalies.
They don't have anything to worry about there. You're right.
Yeah.
Those guys are back for next year.
Yeah. Well, good. Well, let's talk about some of the other games that went on during over the past week. And the other games that I have written down pretty much are involving teams that were, at least at the time we recorded last week, were still in the running for a playoff spot. And I'll just list these games real quick because a lot of these have become irrelevant since then. But first and foremost, Philadelphia on the 30th beat the Islanders 6-3, putting a big nail in their coffin. Tampa Bay beat Detroit 5-3 on the 30th. And also on the 30th, Toronto beat Nashville 3-1. On the 31st, the Islanders beat New Jersey 2-1 in a game that they should have and did win. On the 1st, Toronto beat Detroit 5-4, and Montreal beat Tampa Bay 2-1 in overtime. On the 2nd, the Islanders beat Buffalo 4-2, and also Dallas lost to Tampa Bay 6-3. And on the 3rd, Toronto beat Buffalo 4-2. And on the 4th, Washington beat Toronto 4-1, which really gave the Bruins a shot at catching them. And then the Islanders beat Nashville 2-1. So the Bruins, even though as hot as they are, they still haven't been able to catch Toronto in the standings because Toronto's been playing almost as well.
Yeah.
With the exception of that loss to Washington, Toronto's won just about every other game over the past week or two.
Yes.
And the only really what I see happening is Toronto ending up with that two spot, Boston 3, because Ottawa has been struggling. They've lost.
Right.
They've lost quite a few games, and I think Ottawa's falling to the point where they're going to end up in that second wild card spot. So.
I think so. I think they will. I think that's what I see happening, and I think even Toronto is good. I think the Bruins stand a good chance. Wayne,
they can catch Toronto. They certainly can. They're only a point back, and Toronto has a game in hand. And if Boston wins their last two games, and Toronto falls short on one of their remaining games, I think Boston. I could be wrong, but. Well, no, I think Toronto holds the Boston holds the tiebreak. Because I looked at the tiebreak situation last night. I was looking at it because it shows that Boston's clinched the playoff spot, but yet Ottawa and Toronto, who both have a point above Boston, or above them in the standings, have not clinched yet. I'm like, how can that be? Well, right. first tiebreak is fewer games.
Ottawa is below them, Wayne.
Right. But Toronto's above them.
That's right.
So, and the first tiebreak, because Toronto and Boston are actually technically tied in points, I think. Well, let me pull up the standings real quick, so we can see that firsthand. All right. And while we're in here, we can talk about the standings for everybody, but let's focus in on this part of the standings right now. So I've got Ottawa at 94 points, Boston at 94 points, Toronto at 93. Ottawa and Toronto have a game in hand on Boston. But see, Boston's now sitting technically on NHL.com in the third spot with a playoff clinched, but Ottawa is in the second spot and haven't clinched yet.
Right.
So I looked at the tiebreaks. How can that be? How can Boston be clinched and be behind Ottawa in the standings? Well, the first tiebreak is fewer games played. Well, at the end of the season, it's all going to be the same. They're all going to have 82. So that's a wash. The next tiebreak is regulation and overtime wins. So they take your wins and they subtract your shootout wins from the total. Well, in that tiebreak, Boston beats both Ottawa and Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
So if Ottawa, Toronto, and Boston all end up with the same number of points at the end of the year, Boston will be the highest remaining seed of that group.
Right.
So what I'd like to see is Boston squeak into that second spot. They'll end up with home ice on the first round, which will be huge if they can pull that off.
Right.
So, anyway, but with that in mind, the rest of the Eastern Conference standings go pretty much as follows. You got Washington at 114. You've got Pittsburgh at 109. Columbus at 106. Montreal is the top seed in the Atlantic at 101. Ottawa, again, at 94. Boston, 94. And then your two wild cards are the Rangers at 100. And Toronto with 93.
Yeah.
So, and then everybody else is behind. You got the Islanders at 88, so they're 5 points back. Tampa Bay at 88. Neither of those two are technically eliminated yet, but it's damn close. Philadelphia.
Toronto must win a game. Toronto has to win a game. I think they have three left.
Yep.
They have to win one.
And they will. They've been playing very well.
Both teams are out if they win one game.
Yeah, and if Ottawa wins, both teams are out too. So, yeah, both teams, Tampa Bay and the Islanders, are on the verge of getting knocked out. And then as far as teams already eliminated officially, Philadelphia with 85, Carolina 84, Florida 77, Buffalo 76, Detroit 76, New Jersey with 70. So, so that's how the East lays out. So we essentially have I'm going to call it done. It's going to be Boston, Ottawa, Toronto in those last three playoff spots. And the Islanders and Tampa Bay are going to be out. I just don't see anything else happening in that sense.
Yeah. Now I think it's going to be 95, 96 points is what it was required this year to get in.
Yep.
And that's high. That's a lot of points you got to have to get in the playoffs this year.
Sure is. And what do you think of the Rangers being in that first wild card? Looks like, unless something major happens, I think they're pretty much locked into Montreal in the first round.
I believe what they got to do, Wayne, to assure that is get a point in their last three games, and they get the top wild card spot. Nobody can catch them on that. So, I at 100 points, and they're just a wild card team.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
It's been a very tough year.
They may very well end up with a better record than Montreal, but have to go on the road to start the playoffs.
Yep. As goes Carey Price, so go the Montreal Canadiens. It's very hard to win in the Bell Center.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to tell you, I just say it right now, I'd much rather be playing the Montreal Canadiens than I would being in that third spot and having to play the Pittsburgh Penguins. I just that's not the, you know.
Yeah.
I just don't see that. They are a terribly difficult team to play against in the first round, as far as the Rangers are concerned.
And the Columbus Blue Jackets are going to be rewarded with that. It's pretty much going to happen. I mean, the way the standings are, there's enough separation between the teams that our playoff matchups are looking like Washington is going to end up, well, with whoever ends up in that eighth spot. So the bottom three we don't know yet because the teams are all so close. But the Rangers are going to end up playing Montreal. Columbus is going to play Pittsburgh.
Yep.
So, and what we don't know yet is the other two series.
Yep.
So, now, let's take a look at the West. The West has been locked up for a week now. I think we called it locked up last week, and I think it became official a couple of nights ago.
Yeah.
In the Central Division, you have Chicago with 108, Minnesota with 102, St. Louis 93, Anaheim with 101 in the Pacific, Edmonton with 97, San Jose 97. And your wild cards are Calgary with 92, Nashville with 92. And on the outside looking in, and it's official now, LA with 83, Winnipeg 83, Dallas 77, Vancouver with 69, Arizona 68, Colorado with 47. Boy, they're way back.
Yeah.
So, looking at the matchups in the West, it looks like Chicago will play either Calgary or Nashville, depending on who ends up with the points at the end of the season. Calgary holds the tiebreak with Nashville if they end up tied in points. And so that would put Nashville in the eighth seed, unless they can get one more point than Calgary. And then you'll have Anaheim playing the other team, either Calgary or Nashville, whichever one Chicago doesn't play.
Right.
And then Edmonton is going to play San Jose in the first round. That should be a good series. Wow. And Minnesota will play St. Louis.
Yeah.
In the next round.
I think the harder opponent for Chicago would be the Calgary Flames, don't you? I think Nashville is the weakest team in the playoffs this year. I'll say it like that.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. And it looks like, though, Nashville could catch St. Louis potentially and get in that third spot. So St. Louis could potentially drop into that last spot. Now, St. Louis, Chicago, that would be a series.
That'll be a good series.
If that were to happen.
Yep.
But yeah. I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing Edmonton, San Jose.
Yeah.
San Jose, the veterans of the playoffs that they are playing, you know, all the newbies in Edmonton.
Yes, it's good. That's going to be a good one.
That'll be an entertaining series. That one is pretty much locked in for the most part. All right. So now that we've taken a look at the standings, you got anything else you want to add to all this?
No, I'm looking forward to it, though, because, Wayne, this time next week, the playoffs will be on they will be getting ready to start. In fact, they will start while we're doing our podcast.
Yep.
Unless some unforeseen scheduling thing comes up where we're not recording that night.
Yep.
So that's going to be a good night.
Well, if I can get out of work early enough, we may want to try to record earlier that evening so we can get it done. Because if Boston ends up playing on Wednesday, and I know the Rangers, if they end up playing Wednesday, I'll want to watch, and you'll want to watch your team right from the beginning of the game. So,
absolutely.
So I'll see what I can do about getting getting our recording done early so we can get to watching the game.
Yeah.
But yeah, we'll be recording basically on opening night of the playoffs. So, good deal. All right, well, let's take a quick break just to remind everybody that, again, you can find us on basically anywhere you can get podcasts. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, Google Play Music, Player.fm. You can pretty much any Android or Apple app that you use to get your podcasts, you can find us there. You can find us on our website at thehockeynuts.com. And you can also find us at the Hockey Writers website at thehockeywriters.com. And you can find us on there. If you go onto their website and click on the podcast channel, you can find us among the lists of other NHL or hockey-related podcasts, for that matter. And, of course, if you want to support the show, we do this thing just for fun, but it does cost us money each month to produce, and we're exploring monies to, or exploring options to allow everybody who listens to us to help us cover the cost of producing it. And right now we have a couple of affiliate programs or relationships that we use that if you'd like to support us, if you just go to our website at thehockeynuts.com and you can click on the affiliate links to the right of that page. Right now we have on that page amazon.com and hockeymonkey.com, and any purchases you make after clicking those links, a little bit of the purchase will come back to us. And of course your purchases there won't cost you anything more than they would otherwise. And we're also looking at other possible affiliate links or companies that have affiliate programs that we could get involved with. We've talked to a couple of them when we met over the past weekend that I need to get on, and I just haven't had a chance to do so far. And of course, additionally, we're looking at ways for you to directly support us through a donation program. And I think right now I'm real close to creating a Patreon account. So if you're familiar with Patreon, you'll know how that works. We just need to figure out different give backs to those who, or we need to figure out what we want to do for those who support us through Patreon. I want to give them something extra that we don't give to anyone who just merely listens for free. So, and Steve and I will be talking about that at some point. And finally, if you want to support us without supporting us directly or indirectly financially, just share the show with other hockey fans that you know. And if you have iTunes app on your computer device, subscribe to the show there. It'll help us rise the rankings. And, of course, you can also give us a review on iTunes, and that will help us get noticed there as well. You can like, comment, and share our content wherever you see us on various social media pages. I'm pretty active on Facebook and Twitter right now. I haven't gotten involved with any of the other ones, but that's not saying we won't do it in the future. And then, of course, we want you to get involved with the show. Give us emails, voicemails. We have a way for you to contact us, tweet us. You know, you name it, we do it. My Twitter handle is at WayneHalley9. Steve's is at SBall504Man. Our email address is at feedback@thehockeynuts.com. And if you want to leave us a voicemail, it's at 919-960-1718. And our Facebook page is at facebook.com/thehockeynuts. And our YouTube channel is at thehockeynuts.com/YouTube. And speaking of YouTube and Facebook, as we get into the playoffs, I don't know what I'm going to be doing personally, but I'm thinking of doing some sort of a live stream during the playoffs of some kind. I don't know what. Could be something as simple as I'm going to live stream myself watching the Bruins. I don't know. just throwing that out there so you can watch me go crazy.
We may do that together, Wayne.
Yeah, something.
We've talked about it, and I may take a Thursday off from work and do a podcast with you where it doesn't matter, you know?
Yep.
Yeah.
So we'll come up with something, and we'll let everybody know as we get closer. So, all right. Well, let's get back to the news. And
I had one thing I wanted to say.
Oh, sure.
I want to wish Mark Allred of the Black and Gold Hockey Podcast all the best. I understand he's got some procedures and stuff coming up. We continue to listen to the Black and Gold Hockey Podcast each week. And it's a great prep for me for this show, but I'm happy those guys get to see their team in the playoffs, and wish Mark all the best. And I just wanted to say that real quick.
I certainly second that as well. Obviously listening to his show, we found out that he's going to be missing some time there, and to take care of some health issues, and we wish him the best for sure. So we want to get him back and healthy and get him back doing his podcast, because I don't get my prospect information anywhere else. He does all the work for me in terms of Bruins prospects. So
he is the best.
All right. Okay, so let's get on to the news that's happened around the league. And well, obviously, we're going to start out with some transactions. And we've had a number of college signings that have happened so far in the past week. And going back to the 30th, because I think we had done them all through the 29th on the last one. So we're starting with the 30th now. Tyson Yost out of the University of North Dakota has signed with the Colorado Avalanche, and I know he's already gone right straight to the Avalanche, because I saw a video of this week of his granddad, his granddad wiping the tears from his eyes as he watched his grandson making his NHL debut. So,
yeah,
I know Tyson's already playing in the NHL. The next player, C.J. Smith, out of UMass Lowell's with the Buffalo Sabres. Tucker Poolman, defenseman out of the University of North Dakota, is signed with the Winnipeg Jets. Garrett Pilon, a forward out of Kamloops Blazers, is signed with the Washington Capitals. Marcus Hogberg, a goaltender out of Linköping Hockey Club in Finland. I don't even know if I said that right. Is with Ottawa. Nick DeSimone, a defenseman signed out of Union College, is headed to San Jose. Mike Vecchione, one of the Hobie Baker finalists, a forward out of Union College, is signed with the Philadelphia Flyers. And he was, I believe, a free agent signing. I don't believe he was drafted. So Philadelphia got essentially a free draft pick there to get a Hobie Baker finalist. And, of course, you know, Vecchione, he's obviously Italian. Couldn't pick a better place than Philadelphia, could he?
Yeah, they'll be, God, they'll be loving him, man.
Yep. Warren Fogle, out of Erie Otters, has signed with the Carolina Hurricanes. Spencer Smallman, a forward out of St. John Sea Dogs, has also signed with the Carolina Hurricanes. Angus Redman, goaltender out of Michigan Tech, is signed with the Anaheim Ducks. Colin White, forward out of Boston College, is signed with the Ottawa Senators. Jakob Forsbacka Carlson, forward out of Boston University, has signed with the Boston Bruins. And Connor Ingram, goaltender, Kamloops Blazers, signed with the Tampa Bay Lightning. So, and of course, additionally, we have, speaking of Boston Bruins, you have the Charlie McAvoy situation. He actually still hasn't officially signed a contract. He is on a pro tryout contract, and he's playing in Providence. And there's been a lot of talk coming out of Boston where, why isn't he with the Bruins? Why isn't he with the Bruins? Well, my personal opinion is I hope he doesn't sign with the Bruins this year, because they'll burn.
They don't lose a year of eligibility.
Burn a whole year of his initial contract to play just, what, two or three games? It doesn't make sense. At least in the Bruins' standpoint, it doesn't make sense. So anyway, we talked about that last week. We don't need to rehash it. All right. So did you see any other signings or any other transactions that you wanted to add?
I'm not aware of anything. I know that Colin White did sign with Ottawa.
So he's playing up in Ottawa then.
Putting his jersey on, yeah. So that's the only one that I mean, you've got some here that I was not aware of.
Yep. Okay. All right, so let's move on to injuries then. And there were quite a few this week and some big names.
Yep.
First and foremost, Pittsburgh Penguins defenseman Chris Letang will have surgery for a herniated disc in his neck and miss the entire Stanley Cup playoffs. Quote from him, "Right now it's hard to swallow," Letang said. "It was not expected. Like I've done in the past, I'm going to put my energy into getting better." Letang is expected to be sidelined 4 to 6 months. Chris had been making progress and was hopeful of returning to playoffs until about a week ago, when the progress plateaued. He underwent another MRI, and at that point, it was determined that surgery was needed. The Penguins will have to attempt to repeat the Stanley Cup champions without him, and he hasn't played since February 21st, has 34 points in 41 games. Pittsburgh is 5 points behind the Capitals for first place in the Metro and the Eastern Conference and the NHL.
Yeah.
In addition to Letang, the Penguins are currently without forwards of Evgeny Malkin, Carl Hagelin, Chris Kunitz, Ryan Rust, and Tom Sestito, and defenseman Olli Maatta and Trevor Daley. Wow. Yeah. Sullivan said Malkin has been skating the past couple days and is optimistic he'll be ready for the playoffs. So if Pittsburgh is ripe for the picking, it's definitely in the first round. Get them before they get all these guys back. But not having Letang is going to be a huge, huge hit to their defensive core.
I agree. Of course, a healthy Sidney Crosby and Evgeny Malkin are great equalizers for that team. And Matt Murray, once again, is shining this year. So
He's been playing very well late.
Yep.
All right. Well, next couple of these are actually players that are coming back from injury, and I added on here because both these guys haven't been playing for a long time. So first and foremost, Clark MacArthur hadn't played alongside his teammates in 16 months. So being back brought some tears to his eyes. Once thought lost for the season, MacArthur made his big comeback in the Ottawa Senators 2-0 win against Detroit Red Wings on Tuesday and played 9 minutes 44 seconds. It was a long road back for MacArthur, who had not played in a game since October 14th of 2015 because of post-concussion syndrome. And the Senators named him the third star of the game. So that was awful nice of them.
Yeah.
Because he really didn't contribute much to the game. He only played 9 minutes, basically fourth line minutes. And I looked that up. He didn't have any shots on net or anything like that. But good to see that he's back. I would imagine with them still fighting for a playoff spot, that they're not going to push him too far into service just yet. Ease him back into things. And he'll probably be a healthy scratch to start the playoffs, I would imagine. But who knows? We'll see.
That's right.
And the other one, Carolina Hurricanes forward Brian Bickell played his first NHL game Tuesday since being diagnosed with multiple sclerosis in November. Bickell, who's 31, says he appreciates the support he's received since his diagnosis. Bickell, who had not played for the Hurricanes since October 30th, said his return didn't go as he drew up in his head. He was a -2 in 12:35 of ice time in a 5-3 loss to the Minnesota Wild. His line with Ming's wings, Andrew Pudorowski, I can't even say his name, who's making his NHL debut last night, and Brock McGinn, who was on the ice for 2 of 3 Wild goals in the first period. His 3 hits helped quell concerns about his ability to play in the NHL, though. To help him prepare for what lies ahead, Bickell turned to former Wild goaltender Josh Harding, who was also diagnosed with MS back in September 2012 and ended up retiring from the league in 2015. And he actually talked to Harding after the game, and they had a good conversation. What life is like dealing with that disease. So he has 66 goals and 70 assists in 392 career games with the Hurricanes and Blackhawks. And he has 3 Stanley Cup rings with the Blackhawks. So good to see Bickell.
I'm so happy about it. I'm so happy to hear him make his comeback, make it. And kudos to Brian Bickell. I'm very, very thankful that he's able to play.
Yep. And this is one of those cases where, the timing of it kind of, caught my attention. But it's clearly one of those cases where if the Carolina Hurricanes were still in a realistic shot at getting the playoffs, they probably wouldn't have brought him up.
Yeah.
But since they got knocked out, they're doing this guy a solid and getting him, giving him a chance to get back in there now that their season is essentially determined. But either way, it's good to see Bickell back. I hope he continues to get better and, at dealing with MS, and maybe he can squeak out another year or two of service before he has to call it quits for good. So he is into his 30s now. So his career would be coming down, shortening anyway, but this will make it a little bit more difficult for him to continue. But, yeah, he had been playing in the AHL with the Charlotte Checkers for a month or so now when he started playing for them. So, all right. Well, next injury I've got. Center Joe Thornton will not play for the San Jose Sharks against the Vancouver Canucks. Or actually didn't play last night, which was Tuesday night, because of an apparent left knee injury. Thornton had an MRI on Monday, but Coach Peter DeBoer did not reveal the results. Thornton declined the interview request, but said he would talk to reporters on Wednesday. Thornton, who's 37, has appeared in 201 consecutive regular season games, a streak that began on January 10, 2015. He missed 9 games, 7 because of injuries, 2 while suspended since coming to San Jose from the Boston Bruins in a trade back on November 30th, 2005. Thornton was injured late in the first period of a 3-1 win at Vancouver on Sunday when he collided with Canucks forward Michael Chaput along the boards. Thornton's left knee appeared to buckle, and he struggled to skate off the ice before hobbling to the locker room. He's fourth on the team with 50 points in 79 games. The Sharks are without center Logan Couture, who will miss his fifth straight game since being hit in the mouth by a puck after a deflection of a shot by defenseman Brent Burns against the Nashville Predators on March 25th. DeBoer said, "I expect both of them will be back at some point. Until then, I'm going to call it day to day. I don't have a time frame on it." So basically, these guys, they'll probably be back for the playoffs.
Yes. Yeah, they will.
Because they're going to need both those guys, for sure.
Yep.
All right. Montreal Canadiens defenseman Shea Weber will miss at least the next 2 games because of a lower body injury, Coach Claude Julien said Monday. Weber was sent back to Montreal to be evaluated and won't play, or he didn't play, in Florida on Monday. Or at Buffalo, he won't play on Buffalo on Wednesday, which is tonight. Canadiens, who have 4 games left, can clinch first place in the Atlantic Division with a win against the Panthers in any fashion on Monday, which they, in fact, did get that win, and they have the division. They can also clinch if they got 1 point against the Panthers and the Leafs lose to the Sabres. But either way, Montreal did get that point. Weber is tied for second among NHL defensemen with 17 goals and has 42 points and a plus 20 in 78 games. This will be his first game or first couple games Weber has missed this season. So, another case, he'll be back for the playoffs.
Yes, he will. No doubt about that.
And they're going to need him.
And they're going to need him.
Yep. And this was a scary one. Philadelphia Flyers goalie Michael Neuwirth collapsed prior to the neutral zone faceoff at 7:37 into the first period of the Flyers' 3-0 win against the Jersey Devils at Wells Fargo Center on Saturday. He was removed to the ice on a stretcher and taken to the hospital. All of Neuwirth's diagnostic testing came back normal, and he was supposed to be reevaluated Monday, but I haven't seen any updates on his condition. GM Ron Hextall said, "My understanding is that his sinus was clogged up, and that has something to do with it." He said prior to Flyers game against the Rangers at Madison Square Garden on Sunday. Hextall added that dehydration may have also played a role. Neuwirth is expected to make a full recovery. The Flyers medical staff was aware of Neuwirth's sinus issue, but Hextall said there were no indications before the game that he was susceptible to losing consciousness and passing out. He was feeling fine, but he felt this way for I don't know how long, Hextall said. This wasn't the first day. Anthony Stolarz replaced Neuwirth and made 26 saves. Stolarz had been recalled from Lehigh Valley of the American Hockey League earlier Saturday after Steve Mason was too ill to play because of a stomach illness. So I guess it looks like that Neuwirth is going to be fine. But at the time when it happened, I don't know if you saw the overhead cam video, but he showed him slunched over getting ready for the faceoff, and then all of a sudden
he just went straight back.
He just went straight back and laid flat on the ice.
Wayne, it was eerily similar to the injury suffered by Andre Pavlik with the Winnipeg Jets like 2 or 3 years ago. And actually, my wife and I were watching that game when it happened. He was playing the Rangers. Mm-hmm. And the same thing happened. He went straight back on the ice and completely collapsed. And they never found out what was wrong with him.
Yeah.
They took him to the hospital. They did all these tests, and they really never found out what was wrong with him.
Wow.
So I was – that's a scary thing to see that.
Yeah. Yeah. So it looks like in this case, and I would think dehydration is probably more of a part of it than
I think that's what it is.
Yeah.
You know, and they considered that as one of the options with Pavlik. Same thing. Yep. Dehydration plays a big role.
Yep. Yeah, especially these guys are, I mean, they've as fit as they are, they can't.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yep. They gotta have themselves running in peak condition. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it looks like Neuwirth will be fine going forward. It's not anything heart or brain or anything related like some of the other issues we've had this year.
Mm-hmm.
All right, next one. New York Islanders center John Tavares is week to week with a lower body injury sustained in a 2-1 win against the Devils on Friday. New York captain was battling control for the puck behind the Devils' net late in the third period and tried to avoid New Jersey defenseman Steven Santini, but fell to the ice holding the back of his left leg. He needed two teammates to help him get to the locker room. Tavares leads New York with 66 points in 77 games. If the Islanders don't make the playoffs, which is likely to be, his season may be over. It's a big blow, Coach Doug Waite said Friday. Anytime you see your best player go down, it's obviously he was in some distress. These guys have been around. Injuries happen. It's not fun, but it gives somebody a chance, right? It's going to give us some more minutes to throw around some big challenges at a good time of year. Well, glad he's taking it, you know, positively, so, but
it looks serious to me.
The Islanders are pretty much. Yeah. I mean, yeah, close. I don't see you. You don't have your best player, and you're 5 points back with three to play.
Yeah. No, the Islanders are toast, and. You know, he didn't, you know, that looked like a serious injury to me. One that may take, a couple months to get better from. Maybe it's a hamstring. I don't know. But
yeah, the way he grabbed his leg, it looked like probably a hamstring or a groin of some kind. Yeah.
Yep.
So.
Yeah.
All right. Next one, Dallas Stars forward Curtis McKenzie returned to Texas on Friday after he was hospitalized because of an eye injury. McKenzie was injured when he was hit by a stick off of Bruins defenseman Kevin Miller in the third period of a 2-0 loss at TD Garden on Thursday. McKenzie has 16 points in 53 games this season, his third with the Stars, and I don't have an update on his condition, but sounds like he's going to miss a few games there. Philadelphia Flyers forward Matt Reed will miss the final five games of the regular season with an upper body injury. Reed, who's 30, was injured blocking a shot by New York Islanders defenseman Nick Leddy in a 6-3 win on Thursday. CSN Philly reported Reed may have broken his arm. He had 19 points in 63 games this season, so his season is done because
yes.
Philadelphia is done. All right, we've got some milestones and records and honors to talk about this week. To start with, Toronto Maple Leafs rookie center Austin Matthews set two more records during a 4-2 victory at the Buffalo Sabres on Monday. Matthews, who's 19, scored his 39th goal in his 78th game during the first period. That moved him past Neil Broughton for most goals by a United States-born NHL rookie. Broughton was 22 when he scored 38 goals in 73 games for the Minnesota Wild North Stars during the 81-82 season. It's also the most goals by an NHL rookie since Alex Ovechkin of the Capitals, who was 20 at the time, scored 52 goals in 2005-2006. Of course, yeah, I was going to say Ovechkin was not 18, 19 years old either because...
Nope.
He would have started a year earlier because of the lockout.
Yeah.
The rookie record is 76, set by Timo Solani of the Winnipeg Jets in 92-93. I don't see that record ever being broken.
Yeah.
The goal gave Matthews 67 points on the season, setting a Maple Leafs rookie record. The previous high was 66 points in 80 games by Peter Inacek in 82-83. Now, setting a rookie record for the Carolina Hurricanes or the San Jose Sharks is, you know, not that big a deal, but a team is the history that the Maple Leafs have, setting a record there is pretty impressive.
Yes, it is. You're talking about one of the best teams of all time, second most Stanley Cup wins.
Well, with over 100 years of history to go with it, so.
Yeah, there's
Toronto that, Maple Leafs essentially they really do predate the league, so.
Right. That's true. So true, Wayne.
So yeah. So,
yeah. One of the best talents to come out, him and Connor.
Yep.
If Connor hadn't been injured, the same thing could be said there.
Yep. Oh yeah. But yeah, with Matt, I mean the talent that is coming out of the league right now is incredible. You're going to see a change in the guard. You're not going to see in a few years, you're not going to see the same teams winning over and over again, you know. Seems like every year we have the Sharks, the Blackhawks, the Penguins, the Capitals. You know, they're in there every year.
Yep.
In a few years, we're going to start talking about the Maple Leafs, the Oilers, you know, the Winnipeg right. Jets, you know, with some yep. of the players that are coming up through.
Yep.
There's going to be a changing in the garden, and hopefully the Carolina Hurricanes with all the talent they've got, the young talent they've got, so.
And maybe even the Las Vegas Golden Knights.
Yeah. Although they only have one player right now, so
yep.
it's a little early to call them a up-and-comer.
But he's getting ready. I see him kicking the soccer ball around by himself.
Yep.
Before
he's,
the game.
He's so got nobody. He's definitely... got nobody to play with, yeah. Kind of hard to play soccer when you got no one to play with.
That's right.
Yeah. So anyway, all right. Well, the next one I have, Chicago Blackhawks left wing Artemi Panarin, the bread man. Washington Capitals left wing Marcus Johansson and Edmonton Oilers goaltender Cam Talbot were named this week's three stars for the week ending April 2nd. Panarin led the league with 5 goals in 4 games to help the Blackhawks clinch first place in the Western Conference. Johansson led the league in assists and points with 8 points and 7 assists as the Capitals won 3 of 4 games to maintain their hold on first place in the overall NHL standings. And Cam Talbot went 3-0-0 with a 1.66 goals against average and .946 save percentage to help the Oilers earn victories against 3 Pacific Division rivals and clinch a postseason berth for the first time in 10 years.
Yeah.
The last time they were in the playoffs, they went to the Stanley Cup Final and lost to our Carolina Hurricanes.
That's, you know what? That's right.
Yep. All right, more league honors. Toronto Maple Leafs center William Nylander, who led all rookies with 14 points in 14 games, has been named the NHL's Rookie of the Month for the month of March. Nylander edged Carolina Hurricanes right wing Sebastian Aho, who had 13 points in 17 games, Pittsburgh Penguins teammate Jake Guentzel, and Matt Murray, and Columbus Jackets, Blue Jackets defenseman Zach Werenski for the honor. Nylander accumulated all of his points during a 12-game streak from March 3rd through the 28th, setting a record for the longest point streak by a rookie in Maple Leafs' 100-year history. His 12-game run also tied for the longest point streak by any player in the NHL this season. Nylander, the 8th overall selection in the 14 draft, ranks 3rd among rookies with 58 points and 75 games so far this season. He also places in the top 5 among rookies in power play points, power play goals, assists, power play assists, goals, and shots on goal. The 20-year-old Calgary native also won Rookie of the Month honors in October. So another Toronto Maple Leaf. These Toronto Maple Leaf guys just keep making the news left and right here. Because you got Nylander, you've got Mitch Marner, you've got Austin Matthews. I mean, that core of 3 right there, just to start with up you know, at forward anyway, it's going to make Toronto a dangerous team.
And a team with I still say that, right, they have more fans than anybody. The Toronto Maple Leafs are the fan.
They're the New York Yankees of hockey, for sure.
They are. They're the number one supported team in the NHL.
Yep. Yep, without a doubt.
Yep.
And it's a fan base that is dying for some sort of playoff success, because it's been a long time since they've won the Stanley Cup.
Incredibly loyal fan base. Toronto has very, very good fans. Yep. It's a fact.
Yep. So, well, Toronto's also, you know, always been known as the world capital of hockey, or at least the self-proclaimed one anyway.
Yeah.
No, no disrespect to Hockey Town and, you know, some of these other towns that call themselves the world capital of hockey. Toronto really is. All right. Tampa Bay Lightning right wing Nikita Kucherov, Columbus Jackets blue goaltender Sergei Bobrovsky, and Chicago Blackhawks right wing Patrick Kane were named NHL's three stars for the month of March. Kucherov paced the NHL with 22 points in 14 games and also led the league with 6 power play goals to power the Lightning to a 10-4-1 March. Bobrovsky went 9-1-1 with a 1.09 goals against average, 967 save percentage, and 4 shutouts to guide the Blue Jackets to a 10-4-2 March, helping the team clinch its third all-time playoff appearance. Kane ranked second in the NHL with 22 points in 16 games as the Western Conference leading Blackhawks posted an 11-3-2 March to clinch their 9th consecutive playoff berth. How about those numbers for Bobrovsky? Holy cow.
Yeah, he is definitely going to be a Vezina finalist, wouldn't you say, Wayne?
The numbers he's putting up, I would not be surprised if he won it.
And, you know, I got to say this. At the first of the year, I did not think highly. I was like, you know, that's a problem for Columbus. They got to get it fixed, because I don't know that he's the best goalie for them. He's not, you know, and here he has a I'm eating my words, and I have a tremendous egg on my face, because Sergei Bobrovsky has been stunning in goal this year. He's tremendous. I think he should win the Vezina, but, you know, anyways. Yep.
There's a lot of good goalies that are putting up some numbers, but he's right there with them. Question is, will he continue it in the playoffs?
That's right.
That's yet to be proven from him anyway. All right, and finally, we have a retirement to announce. Patrick Elias has officially announced he's retiring. He did that on Friday as an NHL player after 20 seasons, all with the New Jersey Devils. The forward will skate with the Devils in warmups prior to their final home game of the season on April 8th against the New York Islanders. Elias, who will turn 41 on April 13th, retires as the Devils' leader in goals, assists, points, power play goals, and power play points and game-winning goals. The two-time Stanley Cup winner, which he won in 2000 and 2003, is first in Devils history in playoff goals, assists, points, power play goals, and power play points, and is tied for the most in game-winning goals with Scott Stevens, Peter Sikora, and Claude Lemieux and Jamie Langenbrunner. The Devils announced that Elias is 26 will be retired prior to a home game next season. It will join Scott Stevens, number 4, Ken Danico's number 3, Scott Niedermeyer's 27, and Martin Brodeur's number 30 in the Prudential Center rafters. Elias has not played since April 9th of last year, when he had a goal and 2 assists in last season's finale, a 5-1 win against the Maple Leafs. He hoped to return for another season but needed to have cartilage replacement surgery on his right knee on May 11th. It was second surgery on the knee in 4 months. Although he was not under contract, Elias resumed skating in September. He took a short break to go home in the Czech Republic for Christmas and resumed skating in January. He was making progress but stopped in early February. So he obviously decided that he wasn't going to make it all the way back. And I think I saw a quote where he said he could have come back, but he wanted to come back the levels that we were used to seeing from him.
Yeah.
And he didn't feel like he could skate at those levels anymore. So
yeah, he caused a lot of heartache for Rangers fans. I can tell you that. Over the years. You know?
Yeah.
He was a great player.
Yeah, he was.
One of the top players the Devils ever had. So
he was. And that group that he'll be joining in the rafters, they're all from the same team. They're all from those same, what did they win? 3 cups? 4 cups?
They won. Well, Elias won 2, but the Devils won 3.
Three, yeah.
Yeah, They won in 95 after the Rangers, and then 2000 and 2003.
That's right. Yep.
Yep.
So, yeah. So he's a big part of that core that was so good for so long and so boring to watch.
Yeah. Yeah, they
I've
were.
I've always
were.
Hated watching Devils. Yeah. Devils
they
hockey.
Were. They were maybe the ultimate puck control, you know, possession team. They you know, very tough to win against them. God.
They pioneered that style of play, and everybody else followed, and now almost everybody plays that now. So, yeah. Although we're starting to see a swing back the other way nowadays, which is good. Yeah. All right, so that takes us on to you got another one?
One.
Oh, you
one
do?
One more.
Okay.
I have one. Thank you, Wayne. Brendan, I'm so tickled I get to talk about this guy, and I can't believe I haven't talked about him. I don't think I've ever talked about him on our podcasts. But a guy I have a tremendous deal of respect for, Brendan Shanahan.
Yes.
Skated for the last time at Joe Louis Arena, because that arena will close this Sunday.
That's right.
The final game to be played at the Joe.
Yep.
God, I wished I would have got a chance to go to the Joe and watch a hockey game, but I never did. But he borrowed skates from Mike Babcock. Yep. The president of the Toronto Maple Leafs now. He didn't have any skates, and he's like, this is the last time I'm going to be here. So he borrowed skates from Mike Babcock. He borrowed pads from somebody else and a couple sticks he got from somebody. Went down the ice, skated, and shot a few pucks in Joe Louis Arena just this past week.
Yep.
And that, you know, you talk about someone who has the utmost respect for the game and who I mean, he has tremendous charisma. Yeah, that's a charismatic guy, that guy.
Yep.
Brendan Shanahan is Toronto picked a great guy for president. And I just I thought it was great. It touched me when I read about it. And I hope I wish the best for the people in Detroit that Little Caesars. Arena turns out to be just as good as Joe Louis, because the Joe is going to be sorely missed. That was a great place to watch a hockey game.
Everything I've read and seen about the Little Caesars Arena said it's going to be a spectacular place to watch hockey.
And it may be
one up on the Edmonton Arena, which everybody loves.
Yeah,
that Edmonton Arena. And a lot of people are saying this Little Caesars Arena is going to be even better.
Yeah. Good. So, that's...
It'll be a great arena for Detroit to rebuild their program around, for sure.
Yeah.
All right. Let's move on to some suspensions and fines this week. There's actually one suspension that has been actually handed down and one that probably will be handed down. Let's start with the one that's already handed down. New Jersey Devils defenseman Dalton Prout has been suspended for 2 games without pay for interference against Philadelphia Flyers defenseman Radko Gudas during game number 1161 in Philadelphia on Saturday, April 1st. And that was announced on Monday. The incident occurred at 7:59 in the second period. Prout was assessed a major penalty for interference and a game misconduct. Prout is considered a repeat offender under the terms of the collective bargaining agreement, and based on his average annual salary, will forfeit $38,414.64. Did you see this play?
I did not see it, but I read about it.
Okay. I saw it. Basically, Prout came off the bench. Gudas had hit, and I don't remember who he hit, but he had hit somebody pretty hard over in the corner. And as Gudas was coming off the ice during that shift, he was headed to the bench, and he was gassed. You could see the way he was skating. He was gassed. He had his head down, and he was just trying to get to the bench. Prout came off the bench during their line change and just went straight for Gudas. And Gudas was crossing his own blue line heading towards the bench. The puck was way down in the New Jersey end. And Prout came off the bench, went straight for Gudas, and hit him.
Oh. Well, you know, that's a guy that...
Both those guys, Prout and Gudas, are...
I have no, certainly don't have any pity for Radko Gudas.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but.
And Prout and Gudas are both the type of player that they're not known for their goal scoring. We'll just leave it at that. So, Prout earned himself I hope he got a good, he didn't really hit him that hard either, but hope he got his money's worth on that one anyway. Yeah. And speaking of getting his money's worth, Boston Bruins forward Brad Marchand's in the news again.
Yeah. Well, and you know, go ahead with the story, but I'm a Brad Marchand huge fan. So you don't ever tell me anything. I know his persona and I love it. He's a little guy with a lot of fire in him.
Yeah. As of the recording of this podcast, it's now, 7 o'clock-ish on Wednesday night. All we know now is he's going to have a hearing with the NHL Department of Player Safety on Thursday morning for spearing against Tampa Bay Lightning defenseman Jake Dotchin. The incident occurred at 19:20 of the first period of the game at TD Garden. Marchand received a 5-minute major for spearing and a 10-minute misconduct. The following grounds are being considered for supplemental discipline, spearing, obviously. And then the Department of Player Safety also says that they retain the right to make adjustments to the infraction upon review. I saw the play. Jake, basically, they were essentially battling for a position in front of the net. Dotchin gave Marchand a cross check across the back, yep. Which, you know, as a player, there's not much. Not much protection back there, so it hurts. Yep. And it pisses you off when it happens. Because I hate it when I get cross-checked in the back when I'm playing, you know, beer league, never mind pro. And all Marchand did in that play is he just whipped around and, you know, pitchforked, but just happened to catch Gotchin right in the berries.
In the Gotchin, yeah.
Yep.
In the berries.
Right in the berries, and that put Gotchin on the ice for a few minutes, and the referees felt that they needed to give him a major for that one. So I personally think Marchand's going to end up with a suspension here, but I'll be surprised if it carries into the playoffs.
I hope it doesn't.
Yeah.
It was provoked, and as I said, Marchand, you know, he has a history of suspensions and fines, okay? So it's not like but that's the type of player he is. And he's a blood and guts fighting type guy. And he supports, you know, his team, his teammates. He's not a guy you see going out there trying to hurt people. And we've had a lot of those in the NHL.
Yeah,
but you don't see Marchand participating in that. Most of the time, he's provoked into retaliating. You know, he's a little tough, little fiery guy, and that's just how he is. And I respect the hell out of him. So I'm hoping that it doesn't dwindle over into the playoffs. But he may be gone for the rest of the season, and you know, that's a result of what he did. So
yeah, that's what I'm expecting too. 2-game suspension. He'll be gone for the rest of the season. He'll be back for the playoffs. But look, I'm also a fan of Marchand. Of course I am. I'm a fan of the Bruins. So,
yep.
You know, I want to defend the guy. But at the same time, he can't be doing this stuff in the playoffs. You know,
yeah.
If he does this stuff in the playoffs, he's got to keep his cool because, yeah, like you said, he was provoked. That cross check in the back, what he did was simply a reaction to that cross check.
Yeah,
and he just happened to catch the guy. If he wouldn't have caught the guy right in the berries, we wouldn't be talking about anything right now. You know, if he'd have just got him in the leg,
yeah,
it would have been, you know, it would have been a hockey play. Everybody would have moved on, and probably wouldn't even have been a penalty on it. But just because of where he caught him, and I also want to bring up the fact that just 2 weeks ago, you know, as far as you know, and of course, before I say this. I'm seeing on Twitter and you know Facebook and all the anti Marchand fans, you know, which is basically every non Bruins fan, they're all railing on this guy because you know he's got a history of chippy play or cheap shots or whatever you want to call it. That's what all these people are saying.
He's a fighter.
Yeah,
it's...
but all these people are saying this, but at the same time, 2 weeks ago, you have. Sidney Crosby, who did a premeditated spear of the berries on Ryan O'Reilly and completely got away with it. Not even a penalty on the ice.
I agree. I've seen him do non-provoked things on the ice for kicks. Some guy says, Sid, you really are a kid or something. And you know, he waits for his moment. I've seen him do it.
Yeah, several times.
Yeah. So, that's not the same type of a player as Brad Marchand. As I said, if Marchand does it to you, he's got a reason. You did something. Right. You either went against his teammate, or you did it to him, and he's going to do it right back to you.
Yep.
And that's just the way he is.
Yep.
It's probably been raised that way, Wayne.
Yeah, probably.
You know.
So I guess we'll find out tomorrow whether or not Marchand gets suspended or not. But I'm expecting it. So.
Yeah.
But I'm not expecting it to carry over in the playoffs. The league usually doesn't try to have. They're usually pretty good at you know, stopping these suspensions unless they truly deserve it.
Yeah.
Or they, you know, they think that it's severe enough that it should, because they hold playoff games in high regard. Like, if you get suspended for 3 games in the regular season, well, it's probably only worth 1 game in the playoffs.
Right.
Because each individual game is that much more important. So,
yeah.
At least that's the history I've seen, is suspensions in the playoffs tend to be shorter than because of the fact that each game is that much more important. So that's why I don't expect it to carry over in the playoffs.
Yep.
Unless the league wants to send him a message and throw the book at him, I don't see that happening.
And that better not happen. It's uncalled for.
If they do, they better go back and look at the tape of Crosby and start punishing him for some of the crap he's done.
Yep.
On the ice.
Agreed.
That's all I got to say about that. All right. So let's move on. I've got we're down to some of the other interesting stories that we've had going on this week. And first one I want to talk about is the Women's World Championship. I know we haven't talked about it up to this point, mostly because in my particular belief, I think that in the women's game, it's pretty much a two-team race every year. It's U.S. and Canada. And every once in a while, one of them gets upset, and it's a big upset when it happens. But this year appears to be no different. There was in the Women's World Championship tournament, which is going on right now, there was 8 teams in that tournament: U.S., Canada, Russia, Finland, Sweden, Czech Republic, Switzerland, and Germany. And we're down to the final 4 in that division, or in that tournament. It's going to be USA and Germany in one semifinal, and Canada, Finland in the other semifinal. And fully expect Canada and USA to win those two and end up facing each other once again in the championship of the Women's World Tournament. And the only thing I want to say about that, if you want to see some hockey, what is considered non-checking hockey, and want to see how it played at the highest levels, USA versus Canada, you would not believe that that's a non-check division, because those two teams, when they play each other, it is a slugfest. It really is. Even though the women are much lighter and not as strong as the men, boy, they still knock each other around out there.
Yeah. And
it's usually a pretty fun game to watch when USA plays Canada. So that game, and I don't have the exact date of when that will be. Anyway, if you just go to worldwomen2017.com, if you're interested in seeing, they have all the highlights, the scores, and everything else involved with that tournament. But I'm sure the gold medal game will be shown probably on NHL Network. I wouldn't be surprised if that goes. I know they're streaming it online for sure, but yeah, for those of you interested in the women's game, that's the biggest game of the year right there, the gold medal game of the worlds.
Yeah.
All right, moving on to the next one. Concerning the Olympics, the NHL announced on Monday that it will not participate in the 2018 Pyeongchang Olympics, ending a run of 5 consecutive Winter Olympics with NHL players. Gary Bettman said, "We have previously made clear that while the overwhelming majority of our clubs are adamantly opposed to disrupting the 2017-18 NHL season for the purposes of accommodating Olympic participation by some NHL players. We were open to hearing from any of the other parties who might have interest in the issue. As to the reasons a board of governors might be interested in evaluating their strongly held views on the subject, the NHL said in a statement, a number of months have now passed and no meaningful dialogue has materialized. Instead, the IOC now has expressed the position that the NHL's participation in Beijing is conditioned on our participation in South Korea on 2018. And the NHLPA has now publicly confirmed that it has no interest or intention of engaging in any discussion that might make Olympic participation more attractive to the clubs. As a result, in an effort to create clarity among conflicting reports and erroneous speculation, this will confirm our intention to proceed with finalizing our 2017-18 regular season schedule without any break to accommodate the Olympic Winter Games. We now consider that matter officially closed. NHL Carey Bettman, Commissioner Bettman has repeatedly said in the past several months that owners were against Olympic participation for a variety of reasons. Chief among them was the 17-day break in the schedule required in February, a time when the NFL's season has ended and Major League Baseball season is yet to begin. The NHLPA, in a statement released Monday night, said that the players are extraordinarily disappointed and adamantly disagree with the NHL's short-sighted decision not to continue our participation in the Olympics. Any sort of inconvenience the Olympics may cause to next season's schedule is a small price to pay compared to the opportunity to showcase our game and our greatest players on this enormous international stage. So, all parties don't agree in this one.
No, not at all. Many players pissed.
Yeah.
I've been getting tweets from Henrik Lundqvist. He did not like this at all.
No, he's one of the biggest outspoken opponents from this decision, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I saw some of his tweets, and he's not happy about it. Even though he's one of the players that got hurt at the Olympics last time.
Yeah.
And it probably cost the Rangers some games as a result.
Yeah.
But he still wants to play, and so do many others. Now, right. Capitals owner Ted Leonsis has also, he hasn't said anything since this came out, but previously, he was given Ovechkin his blessing. If Ovechkin wants to go, he's free to go.
Yeah.
So, and I've been watching some of the interviews and some of the talk with agents and stuff like that over the past couple of days. And basically, what's going to come down to, it's going to be a player by player, team by team, owner by owner decision on who's going to go. But ultimately, if a player is going to go and have the team's permission to do so, that player is obviously going to be off the team for the 2 weeks that they're gone, and the games will continue.
Yeah.
So the team will be playing as if that player is injured. So, and then there's also, you know, speculation, well, what's going to happen if players decide that they're going to go anyway, even without the blessing of their team, and what will that, you know, what ramifications on their contract? Would that be a breach of contract? You know, if it gets ugly, that could come out to be the case. Now, I get it. The owners don't want the players going because, obviously, you got 2 weeks there in the best part, essentially the best part of the season or the best time of the season, right after the NFL ends, before baseball begins, where the only competitor the NHL has is the NBA and college basketball, of course. And they don't want to lose that time. So it's money. Money, 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 money is basically right. What this is all about. Yeah. The owners don't want the arenas sitting empty for 2 weeks. And, you know, the risk of a player getting hurt ultimately comes down to money, too.
Yeah.
So this is greedy owners being greedy and not allowing this. Now, I personally feel, depending on what players do get sent there, you know, I wouldn't mind seeing the Olympics go back to using amateurs. Of course, KHL is going to send their players.
KHL is going to send everybody.
Yeah.
You know, professionals from the Finland teams.
Yep.
The Czech teams.
Yep.
There'll be professionals going over there from Russia.
Yep.
You know, Sweden is going to send their players that aren't in the NHL. They're all going to go. The United States is going to be sending junior players. And I'm kind of excited about it, Wayne, after the way the things went at the World Cup with the under 20 team.
Yep.
I'm excited about it, and the United States will have a fighting chance there.
Well, on the good side, there's more hockey for us to watch.
That's right.
Because you'll have the NHL going on and the Olympics going on at the same time.
That's right.
So there's that much more hockey that we can watch. But you also want to see in the Olympics the best players in the world play against each other. But obviously the NHL's made it clear that they don't want the best players in the world playing against each other in a tournament where it's country versus country unless they have a financial stake in the deal. Yep. I.e. the World Cup of Hockey.
Yep.
They were okay with that one.
Yeah. Because
they're the primary financial beneficiary on that tournament.
Yep.
But the Olympics, there's not enough, the old question, what's in it for me?
I let me tell you, Guy, I am looking forward to watching outside the KHL, and that is Sergei Mozyakin, because he will definitely be on the Russian team. There's yep. no doubt about it.
You're right.
And I really haven't seen him play. I've read about him and I've seen clips.
Yep.
And I'd look forward to that.
Yep. Yeah. All the best players of the KHL are going to end up being there, and that will make Russia a clear favorite to win the Olympic gold.
I agree.
Which oh, obviously yes. they're not gonna argue with the NHL being there. They'll sacrifice a few NHL players that are playing over here so that they can put their all-stars in the tournament.
Yeah. That's right.
They'll have a better chance of winning.
Ilya Kovalchuk, Pavel Datsyuk. You look at the players, they're going to show up there.
Yep.
Barring an injury. Sergei Mozyakin.
Yep.
Igor Shesterkin with yep. SKA yep. is probably going to be in net as the goalie.
Right.
So you can go on.
Yep, it should be interesting. But maybe we'll have some other developments about this. But at this point, I don't see the NHL changing its mind. They've essentially drawn the line in the sand, and they're ready to dig in. So yeah, it, like I said, more hockey for us, I guess.
Yeah, that's right.
At that point. All right, let's move on. After playing for more than 7.5 periods in nearly 6 hours on Sunday, Cal Babich evidently had enough. Babich, the son of former NHL player Dave Babich, ended the longest Canadian Hockey League game ever played by scoring at 11:36 of the fifth overtime to lift Everett past Victoria 3-2 in Game 6 of the Western Hockey League first round series. The goal was Babich's second of the game. He also opened the scoring with a goal at 6:31 of the second period. Everett goalie and Philadelphia Flyers prospect Carter Hart made 64 saves and was named the game's first star. Victoria goaltender Griffin Outhouse, a 2017 NHL draft prospect, so he's yet to be drafted, made 72 saves but could not stop Babich's breakaway attempt in the eighth period, 5 hours and 49 minutes after the game started. At 151 minutes, 36 seconds, the game was about 5 minutes longer than the previous CHL record between Victoria and Hull of the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League back in 1999. Everett and Victoria also set the record for longest game in Western Hockey League history, which previously was set at 136 and 56 seconds in a game between Kamloops and Kootenay on March 25th, 2003. But that marathon doesn't go as long as the eight overtime playoff epic in Norway that we talked about a few weeks ago.
Yes.
Or even the longest NHL game between the Red Wings and the Montreal Maroons back in 1936. But it was the second straight overtime game of that series, and Everett ended up winning the best of seven series in six and will play Seattle in the second round. So that's a long game.
That is a tremendously long game, and I don't know. I'd have had to buy popcorn more than once.
Maybe a beer or two as well. All right. After playing for more than 7.5 I'm sorry. I'm redoing the same story. All right. Let's move on. NHL forward Craig Cunningham put on his skates and returned to the ice on Friday for for the first time since going into cardiac arrest before an American Hockey League game back on November 19th. Cunningham was aided by physical therapists and Connor Garland, his teammate with Tucson of the AHL, before a morning skate at Tucson Arena. Cunningham, 26, was Tucson captain when he collapsed before a game against Manitoba. He had part of his left leg amputated and is walking with the help of a prosthetic. He has become a source of inspiration for the Arizona Coyotes and the NHL communities. Cunningham participated in a ceremonial puck drop before the Roadrunners game against San Jose back on March 25th and will drop the ceremonial first puck as part of Fan Appreciation Night before the Coyotes play Minnesota Wild on April 8th. A fourth-round pick of the Boston Bruins in the 2010 NHL draft, Cunningham had 3 goals and 5 assists in 65 games with the Bruins and Coyotes. So I saw the video of that, and it was the smile on his face was priceless to see how great he felt getting back out on the ice.
Yeah.
But you could tell it was difficult for him because, you know, they had to skate on a prosthetic leg. And, of course, you don't have any movement there. And you could tell he was having a little difficult getting used to skating on it. But it was great to see him back out on the ice. Obviously, he won't be able to play, at that level again. But anyway, it's good to see him come back for a guy that almost passed away right there.
Yeah, gosh.
Good to see him make full recovery.
You said that right, Wayne.
Yep. All right. This one I included on here. Tickets for the 2017 NHL Draft at United Center on June 23rd and 24th will go on sale April 7th. The Chicago Blackhawks announced on Friday. The Blackhawks will also host an outdoor festival at United Center throughout the weekend that will feature NHL Centennial Fan Arena and interactive traveling fan experience with honors of past 100 years of hockey, which we just recently experienced. It includes a museum truck, entertainment truck, a ball hockey rink, a virtual reality Zamboni experience, and the Stanley Cup. Now, I included that because if there's anybody out there who wants to sponsor us, we would be happy to go to the draft and report back on everything that's going on there.
I tell you what, there's part of me that I would almost go up to Chicago and stay there for those 2 days. It'd be a blast.
It would be a lot of fun. Man, Chicago's getting a lot of events. They got the Frozen Four. They're getting the draft.
Yep. It's a good town for it. You know, that's a great place to go and celebrate, man.
But yeah, seriously, if there's anybody out there who wants to sponsor us, any company or whatnot, we'll be happy to go. I'd love to go. I'll take the time off and go. But anyway.
Oh, that's good. Thank you, Wayne. That was very well said.
This last one was the announcement we alluded to in last week's podcast that actually happened right after we got done recording.
And I might say you hit the nail on the head on this one. You got it absolutely correct. You nailed it.
Yeah.
But go ahead. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yep. At the invitation of Bloomage International and as a piece of National Hockey League's long-term business strategy in China, the LA Kings and Vancouver Canucks will face off in a first-ever preseason game played in China as part of the 2017 NHL China Games, presented by ORG Packaging, the NHL, and the NHLPA, and Bloomage International jointly announced Wednesday night / Thursday morning. It was Thursday in China, but it happened Wednesday night over here. The preseason games between the Kings and Canucks will be played on September 21st at Mercedes-Benz Arena in Shanghai and on September 23rd at Huxi Live Wuxong's Le Sports Center in Beijing, which is actually the arena that the Kunlun Red Star of the KHL plays at, where last Wednesday's announcement was made. In addition to the NHL and NHLPA, representatives from the Chinese government, the LA Kings, Vancouver Canucks, Bloomage International, and ORG Packaging were on hand for this historic announcement, which advances the NHL's commitment to grow the game globally while furthering the league's international strategy. The 2017 NHL China Games, presented by ORG Packaging, represent the formal launch of what we hope to be a long and successful collaboration between our league, our teams, and our partners in accelerating the development of hockey in China. The NHL Gary Bettman said, "We look forward to our first games in China and to a variety of initiatives that will inspire generations of Chinese players and fans to enjoy our sport. We recognize the importance of helping China build a strong national hockey program and are committed to supporting that priority in every way possible. Now, do you see the obvious conflict here with the with this and then the Olympic announcement?
Yeah. I do see the obvious conflict. It's money, Wayne. I mean, it's you couldn't have said it any better, man.
They're obviously, you know, they're interested in growing the game globally, but only if it benefits their pocketbooks, essentially, is what it comes down to. Because obviously the IOC is not going to give them enough money to make it worthwhile to send their players over there. But they're all right to send them over there for, you know, some exhibition games. And probably what's next, I see it happening. They did it in Europe. They'll do a couple exhibition games next year, but maybe the year after, or the year after that, they're gonna start the regular season over there.
Yep, yep.
And that will, you know, it's just, yeah, it's just one of those things where it's,
yeah,
where it's a money thing, you know. They're, and obviously they're not gonna, the NHL, you can see what's gonna happen. They're gonna skip this Olympic Games. But you're not going to have an Olympics in China when they're trying to grow the game in China.
Yeah.
And they're not going to skip those Olympics. Even if the IOC has said, well, you got, if you want to do China, you've got to do Korea.
Yeah.
That's, you know, what the IOC is saying. And but, you know, I don't know. It's just frustrating to see, you know, the obvious money grabbing going on here. But that ORG packaging actually is a name that I've seen before. And I don't know if we talked about it. It would have been within the first one or two podcasts that we've ever done. The Bruins sent Matt Bolesky and David Pasternak to China last summer to do kind of a hockey camp slash, you know, a lot of public appearances in China. And that was all put on by ORG Packaging.
Oh, okay.
So the relationship, ORG's got a relationship with the Boston Bruins already, an existing one. They're just expanding it league-wide now. And if you watch a Boston Bruins game at home, the ORG Packaging logo is on the boards at the Garden.
Okay.
So, anyway. All right. Well, let's move on to the HockeyNuts.com power ranking for the week.
And yes.
It's your turn this week.
It is my turn. And you know what, Wayne? This just struck me. This will be my last power rankings for the year. Because next week when you do yours, that's the last week, really, that I guess we can still do them, but there will only be 16 teams.
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe that's the way we'll do it.
Yeah.
But this will be my last time doing it with the full slate of teams in the NHL.
Yep.
So it's kind of melancholy for me.
Until next year, of course.
Here we go. Number 16. I think, my opinion, the weakest team in the playoffs, the Nashville Predators. And they were 13 last week, but they're slipping. They've lost some games, and I don't know that they're resting players as much as, you know, they're probably going to be the first round opponent of the Chicago Blackhawks, but we'll wait and see. We'll see what happens.
Yep.
Number 15, Ottawa, another team that's slipping quickly.
Yep.
Losing games. I think their last 10 games, their L10 is terrible. Yep. Two wins maybe. Number 10 last week. So they dropped five slots. Number 14 is the Boston Bruins, up from 16 last week.
And they're white hot right now.
Playing white hot team. And I could have put them up another slot or two, and probably they will go up another slot or two next week. Calgary is number 13. They were number 11 last week. They've dropped a couple. But, again, if I'm the Chicago Blackhawks, I don't want to play Calgary in the first round. That's a much tougher opponent than the Nashville Predators. Number 12, the St. Louis Blues. And St. Louis could factor into this wild card thing. That's another team Chicago doesn't want to play. Number 12, they were number 14 last week. They move up a couple slots. Number 11, The biggest moving team I have this week is the Toronto Maple Leafs. They move up from 15 last week, and they're playing very, very well as the playoffs approach. 8-1-1 in their last 10. They're the hottest team in the NHL. Number 10, the San Jose Sharks. They were number 12 last week, so they've moved up a couple. They need to get Joe Thornton back for the playoffs, but I'm expecting a good playoffs out of the San Jose Sharks, and time will tell as to where they go. They get by their first-round opponent. Watch out for them.
Yep.
Number 9, staying steady from 9 last week, the Edmonton Oilers. Number 8, the Anaheim Ducks. Moving up from 10 last week, and they've clinched, they may not have clinched it, but they will clinch the Pacific Division. And that's another tough playing team in the playoffs. And Randy Carlyle, he's won the Stanley Cup with them. He knows what he's doing. That'll be a very interesting team to watch for you guys out on the West Coast. Number 7, Minnesota, moving down from number 6 last week. And they have not looked really good as of late. Wayne, what do you think?
They've been kind of up and down.
Yeah.
They're playing, you know, it depends on what game it is, I guess. They're just not playing consistent, I guess.
Yeah.
Still a very good team, but just not.
They are.
Just not as consistent as they had been.
Yep. Number 6 is the New York Rangers. They moved down a slot from number 5 last week. They do have to find their game before these playoffs start. Against Montreal, in all likelihood, that's going to be a hell of a series, and the Rangers are going to have their game in, have to bring their A game to that series.
Yeah, they're going to have to tighten up, I guess.
They will.
Tie up some loose ends, so to speak.
Montreal, not the powerhouse offensive team that some of these guys are, and as Montreal has been in years past. That's an area where the Rangers match up against them well.
No, but Carey Price can steal a game though, or two.
And Carey Price is the difference. If he's on, it'd be a very tough series for the Rangers to win.
Yep.
Number 5 is the Montreal Canadiens. They move up from 8 last week. They're going to win the Atlantic. They have won the Atlantic Division.
Yes, they clinched.
So they move up into 5th. Number 4 is the Columbus Blue Jackets. They moved down 1 from last week, and I watched a little bit of that game against Pittsburgh, and they did not look good. That's a team that's going to give them problems in that 2-3 matchup, and it's going to be Sergei Bobrovsky has got to play top of his game.
Yep,
he really does.
That's a series where a legitimate Stanley Cup contender is going to be out of the first round.
That's true.
Yep.
And we're sitting here talking about Columbus that way, but they are one of the best teams in the league. And I've got them at 4 this week.
And I hope they knock off Pittsburgh. I really do.
Oh, gosh. You talked about I'm going to be rooting up and down for them. Number 3, the Pittsburgh Penguins moving up from 4 last week. I don't know how they're doing it. I really don't. If you look
with
at
all the injuries,
I don't know how they're doing it, but they are doing it, and they are definitely priming themselves for the playoffs. That's a tough, tough.
Make them that much more dangerous when those players do come back.
That's true. Number 2, the Chicago Blackhawks, moving up from number 3 last week. Again, another team that's getting ready for the playoffs, and you see it in every game you watch. Chicago has a tremendous amount of the desire and the passion for the game. To be a repeat, another Stanley Cup on their mantle.
I'll be surprised if they don't come out of the West, really.
Yeah, it could be them. It could be San Jose. It might be Anaheim, but Chicago stands a good chance. Number 1, the Washington Capitals, they stay at 1, and, it's all going to depend on how they play in the ever jinxing format they've been in the playoffs. They just sputter.
Yep.
Fortunately, they don't have to play either Pittsburgh or Columbus in the first round. And so I think you can say, Wayne, unless they play Boston in the first, I think they're going to advance. I think they'll beat Ottawa.
No, but Washington will have to play either Pittsburgh or Columbus in the second round. So,
yep.
So they may get by one round, but get, you know, that's been their big problem is getting out of the second round.
Yeah.
That may continue this year.
It very well could. And,
you know, they're running out of years. Ovechkin isn't getting any younger.
That's right. So. That's right.
Well, good. So there you have it. All right. Well, let's take a look at the week upcoming to see how our teams are going to do. First and foremost, the Bruins have just two games left on their schedule. They're the one team on this list that only has two games left. Everybody else has three. The Bruins have Ottawa at home on the 6th and Washington at home on the 8th, which I fully expect Washington will probably sit all the big names. Holtby won't be playing. Ovechkin won't be playing. I mean, they can't sit everybody, but probably the top two or three players that they've got, including goaltender Holtby, will be sitting for them against the Bruins because that's in both games are in Boston. And then the Ottawa game, of course, is a must-win if they want to stay out of that eighth spot. So
seller position.
Yep. All right. So the Rangers have three.
Three tonight against Washington. A game that I'd like to see. I'm sure Henrik will be in net, and I'd like to see him win this game. You know, it's a big game for us. If we can win one game, I think it's all over with. We get that wild card spot, and it just kind of solidifies things.
Yep.
Then we go to Ottawa from Washington, play there on the 8th. And that's in all likelihood going to be a game where you start seeing players drop out, especially if we win tonight. They'll rest players on both sides. I look forward to watching that game. And then the final game is on the 9th, and that will be a game where Pittsburgh's not going to play everybody. They're going to rest people, and I expect to see the same probably out of the Rangers.
Yep.
So.
And Carolina. Carolina has three games to finish out the season. They've got the Islanders on the 6th at home, St. Louis on the 8th at home, and then they go up to Philadelphia for their last game of the year on the 9th in a game that will be pretty irrelevant for everybody involved. And I've included two more teams this week because these are the two teams that Boston is fighting for playoff positioning with, and that is Ottawa. They've got Boston on the 6th, of course. They're at the Rangers. At home against the Rangers on the 8th. And then the Islanders on the road on the 9th. And then Toronto also has three remaining. They're at home against Tampa Bay on the 6th, at home against Pittsburgh on the 8th, and at home against Columbus on the 9th. So three tough teams there, but hoping that Toronto will lose two out of three so the Bruins can catch and get that second spot because I really want them to get home ice in the first round. That would be a huge surprise for me in particular.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's move on to the NCAA. And actually, in terms of what's gone on in the last week, really nothing's gone on in the last week. Last time we recorded, the Frozen Four had already been determined. And they basically take a week and a half off. So it still remains four teams left. You got Denver against Notre Dame in the first semifinal and Harvard against Minnesota Duluth in the second semifinal. And both of those games are tomorrow night. They're both on ESPN2 in the U.S. And the first game is at 6 o'clock p.m. Eastern. That's the Harvard-Minnesota Duluth game, and then the late game is Denver-Notre Dame. I'll probably be watching both of those games.
So will I.
And that game's start time is 9:30, but of course, if the Harvard-Minnesota Duluth game goes long, that will be delayed, of course. And then the championship game is Saturday night, 8 p.m. Eastern, on the mothership, ESPN. And of course, I'll probably be watching that, because those three games right there, if you've never seen college hockey before, treat yourself to one of those or all three of those games because it's going to be a good watch.
Yeah,
and
of course, I'm
rooting for Denver in this one because the head coach is a former UMaine player. So,
yeah.
So I am on the Denver bandwagon in this one.
I hear you. And they're probably the odds-on favorite to win it, wouldn't you say, Wayne?
They are the number one of the top remaining seed, yes, in the tournament. So, It's their tournament to lose. But single game elimination in hockey, anything can happen.
That's right.
All right, let's move on to the KHL Minute then.
Yes, sir. I put together something. I don't know.
Go for it.
You want me to go?
Yep.
First, I kind of set up the final. As you know, between this show and last, the Gagarin Cup final has been announced.
Already.
It is already done. Both teams swept. In the East, you have Metallurg Magnitogorsk going back to the finals for the third time in the last 4 years. They will be playing against SKA St. Petersburg, who won the Western Conference. And that sets up SKA won the Gagarin Cup in 2015. Now, I had been reporting, and I was in error. I had thought that Magnitogorsk had won two in a row. They have not. They won the 2014 Gagarin Cup when Mike Keenan coached them.
Yep.
Then in 2015, SKA won the Gagarin Cup. And now in 2016, Magnitogorsk returned and won it again. So this would be their third Gagarin Cup in 4 years.
So these two teams have combined to win the last three.
That's correct.
That stinks of the NBA a little bit.
It does.
Is pretty much dominated by three or four teams.
Yeah.
Which makes, in my mind, the NBA completely unwatchable. So
I would have liked to have seen SKA make it, but CSKA, but yeah. It didn't happen.
But the fact that both finals were sweeps just surprises me, too, because I thought that the other teams involved, AK Bars and Lokomotiv, would have been able to put up a bit of a fight, but turns out they didn't. Both series were 4-0, so they're already – seems like a month ago they started their playoffs. They've already whittled it down to the Gagarin Cup final, and, of course, they haven't played any games yet in that final, but but yeah, something worth paying attention to now. They're in their final series, so let's hope this one goes seven. There hasn't been a seven-game series yet in this whole entire tournament.
That's right. It might. I said the 2016-17 Gagarin Cup final will be contested by the 2015 champion SKA St. Petersburg and the reigning champion Metallurg Magnitogorsk. Both teams earned the right to compete for the KHL Championship's main trophy, thanks to a 4-0 series sweep in the conference final, with SKA defeating Lokomotiv Yaroslavl to become the first in the West, and the men from Magnitogorsk ousting AK Bars Kazan to claim supremacy in the East. The Cup final gets underway Saturday, April 8th, with the final game scheduled for Thursday, April the 20th, if necessary. It is important to note that the KHL has named its best players of the conference finals round. They are best goaltender, and again, I'm tickled pink about this because if he decides to come to the NHL, he is the property of the New York Rangers. Igor Shesshorkin, who has helped his team SKA to victory in three of the four games against Lokomotiv. The 21-year-old netminder, who was drafted by the New York Rangers 114th overall in the 2014 NHL draft, allowed just a solitary goal. This is really something now.
In four games?
He allowed one goal in the three games that he played, achieving the highest save percentage, 98.51.
Wow.
And the lowest goals against average, 0.55.
That's ridiculous.
That's really, really something, isn't it? The best defenseman was Patrick Hersley of SKA, who played all four games against Lokomotiv, firing off 15 shots at goal and ending the series with 4 points, 2 goals, and 2 assists, an efficiency rating of +4. The 30-year-old Swede scored a double in game one, including the crucial game winner in overtime. And the best forward, this is no surprise to us, Wayne, the best forward, you could say it in your sleep, Sergei Mozyakin,
yep,
Magnitogorsk, who played in all four games against Akbars, finishing the series with 7 points and a +5 rating. So once again, Sergei Mozyakin is the Wayne Gretzky of the KHL. There's just no doubt about it.
And
he is.
And he's a guy who's never come over here. It's be interesting to see if he were to ever come over here. But it's he's getting on in his career, and it'll probably never happen because, you know, if he hasn't done it yet, he won't. But yeah, he's a great player.
Yep.
And certainly couldn't said it better myself, the Wayne Gretzky of Russian hockey. For sure. All right. Good story. All right, let's move on to our picks of the week. And, of course, this week we're just going to talk about our weekend at the NHL Centennial Arena. So it's kind of a combined one this week.
Yes, it is. One of the best days of my life. I've been a hockey fan for 40-some-odd years, and I finally got to see the Stanley Cup, and I'm telling you, it is amazing. My wife and I were thrilled. It was just a tremendous day and great weather.
Oh, yeah. That was the main thing that I couldn't believe is the weather that we had for that tournament or for that weekend. Because Friday, going into the weekend, it was kind of cloudy, kind of rainy. Monday, coming out of the weekend, it was kind of cloudy, kind of rainy.
Yeah.
And during the weekend, it just seemed like both days, not a single cloud in the sky. So,
yeah.
I actually went both days. I went Saturday with my son. And what we did is Saturday morning, we got up bright and early. I say bright and early because, you know, I didn't have to get up, but we did. We went to the morning skate. Now, of course, the visiting team morning skate is closed to the public, but we were able to go get in and watch the Carolina Hurricanes morning skate, which really didn't turn out to be nothing. It seemed like just an optional thing where just a few guys just went around and just played around. But one of the things we saw right away was Eddie Lack was back in goal, so that was good to see. He actually played since then. But anyway, we went to the morning skate, and then after the morning skate was done, we got out of there, and it was right about 30 minutes before the gates opened to the NHL or the fan arena. So there was, you know, a small crowd anyway. The Carolina Hurricanes had a game also that night at 7:00. So what essentially happened, and, you know, which I pretty much predicted, was all of the fans that were going to go to this Centennial Fan Arena were probably going to go later in the afternoon on their way to the game. You know, they're going to go to the game.
Yeah.
Get there about, you know, 7:00 game, get there about 4:30, do some tailgating, and then go in the fan arena before they go in the game, which was going to be a huge, huge crowd of people going into that thing. My thought was get there early, get there right when it opened. We can get in. You don't have to fight a crowd, and you know, the wait to get our pictures with the Stanley Cup would be short, and I was right. We got in there about noontime. It was probably about 50 to 100 people waiting to get in when we went in, and we might have waited 15 minutes to get our picture taken with the Stanley Cup. That was it. We were able to do it. And then some of the things that they had there, of course, you know, we've been talking about it for weeks now, but they had, of course, the Stanley Cup was on display. They had the Zamboni thing that you could do, which we didn't bother to do. They had the outdoor ball hockey rink, and they had the trailer truck that had all the museum displays. What'd you think of all that?
Yeah, that was great. I really enjoyed that museum truck. We probably spent 45, half an hour, 40, maybe even close to an hour in there. And, you know, not the coolest of places either.
No, but it was kind of warm in there.
Yeah. It was fun. Those pictures that we took, and it was, I got a lot of pictures in there. And the sticks that were on display, the skates. Records and memorabilia that they've got in that truck. It's really something.
They had a lot of stuff there. And, of course, you know, in addition to that, they had a place where you could donate hockey equipment, which they would donate to kids in need. And of course, Stormy, the mascot for the Carolina Hurricanes, was there, and it was just an all-around good time. But on Sunday, man, did we hit it big on Sunday. I got to tell you, when we got there, we got there a little after noon on Sunday, and because the Hurricanes had a game on Sunday, Saturday night at 7, the NC State football program had their annual spring game there. So there was thousands of people there in the area to see that, and not many of them came over to the NHL, which I was kind of the thing, which kind of surprised me, but it didn't. Surprised me of how out of how many people that were there, so few came over, but it doesn't surprise me because, you know, NC State football fans are not hockey fans. They're just not. All that stuff was going on Saturday, but on Sunday, nothing was going on. The Canes were out of town. They were playing in Pittsburgh at 5 o'clock Sunday afternoon. Nothing going on at the football stadium. There was nothing going on, and except for this Centennial Fan Arena. And man, we were able to spend way more time with the Stanley Cup than I would have ever imagined.
Yes,
I
mean, we were.
We went back. How many times did we go back?
Three times we went back in line.
Yeah, we first one we just got, you know, went in line to get, you know, pictures with you and your wife, and then me and you got our picture, and then we went back another time to do kind of a candid shot with me and you, and then I went back one additional time to take some close-up shots of certain parts of the trophy. I got all those three spots where the Bruins are etched into the cup, plus the Carolina Hurricanes. You went back and got pictures of the Rangers where they're etched in, close-ups of that. So, the opportunity we had with the Stanley Cup was just simply amazing. I mean, a couple of those times it was virtually no wait at all. So, it's something we feel lucky because in a city like Toronto or Boston or New York, to get anywhere close to the Stanley Cup, you're going to wait. You're going to wait a long time.
We'd have never had that chance there.
Yeah.
It's unprecedented, and we got to spend. And when we were up there too, you know, they let us take several pictures and take our time. You know, we got several minutes, 5 minutes.
Yep.
With the cup, every time we were up there, and there was no pressure to get shoo us off or we got people waiting in line. That it was really something.
Like when the cup was here in 2011 for the All-Star game. The lines were so long, they wasn't like that. When the lines are long, they're pushing you. In fact, Saturday when the lines were long to start with, they were saying, okay, one shot, one picture. So they didn't want you to linger around the cup. They wanted you to go in, get your picture, move on. So that the next people in line could go. But on Sunday, we didn't have any of that. I mean,
because
there wasn't that big crowd there fighting to get a spot. We didn't have to, we didn't have to fight for a spot, and they quite frankly gave us more time. So that was amazing. Some of the pictures I got. And in fact, if you are listening to this podcast as an audio podcast right now, you want to go over to our YouTube page, because right now as part of our recording, I'm throwing in some of the pictures that I took over the weekend that shows, you know, one of these pictures is me and my son with the cup. And then you've got some of the pictures inside the trailer. I got a picture of Wayne Gretzky's stick from the 1993 Stanley Cup final. Zdeno Chara's skates from the 2011 final. You know, some of the other pictures we took, Gretzky's helmet. We've got a picture of you going in to get the Rangers engravings. Then I've got a picture of you and your wife. I've got a picture, just the Stanley Cup alone. Of course, you know, the pictures I took zoomed in real close. Oh, then there was that family there that had the baby. Remember them?
Yeah, I do. And how gracious, and we'll talk about him, Howie, the keeper of the cup, was to put the baby inside the cup, set it down on the ground.
He actually took the cup off the pedestal, laid it down on the ground. And this family was able to put their baby inside the cup for the picture.
Absolutely incredible.
And I was able to take that picture with my camera and send that to that family. So they were very gracious or grateful to have that opportunity for sure. And then, yeah, of course, the conversation we had with Howie, that was amazing.
Oh.
Some of the stories he was telling.
Unforgettable. Yep. Unforgettable stories. And what a great guy. Very gracious. Took his time to come over and talk to us for a good 15 minutes, 20 minutes.
Yep, he sure did.
We had a great talk with him. And I learned some things, Wayne, that frankly I didn't know, that there are three cups in actuality. And I learned this from you. You might want to share that with the folks.
Yeah, essentially there's the three cups. Of course, there's the original that's 100 year or 125 years old, actually. It's actually 20. The cup itself is 25 years older than the league itself. That cup resides at the Hockey Hall of Fame permanently because it is too fragile to be handled nowadays because it's so old and has been overhandled for so long. They retired that cup, and I don't remember the year now. It was back in the 50s and 60s when that cup got retired. And then they built the one that we saw that was here, or the one that's traveling. That is the one they've been using ever since then. And then they actually have a replica that they keep at the Hall of Fame so that when this cup is on the road, they have one at the Hall of Fame that fans can look at when you go visit the Hall of Fame. So, and that one is just used simply to replace the real cup when it is not at the Hall of Fame. So,
right.
So hence the existence of three. And everything else is a replica. If there are more than that, they're all replicas.
I found again, as you see so often, the cup looks much better in person than it ever did on TV. It is a brilliant, shining, sparkling, and it is clean. It is beautiful. I found it to be much more, a much better thing to see in person than what you ever see on TV. And I did not see, although you have this commercial that the NHL puts on of all the scratches and imperfections, you really don't see those. You'd have to really study that cup to see a lot of the, problem, maybe they dropped it or the person that did the inscription may have scratched it, things like that happen in time and age as it gets older. I didn't see a lot of that. It looks to be, when you look at it up close, a very beautiful cup and not a lot of damage or showing its wear at all.
Yeah. Well, if you look at the pictures that I took of it, I don't know if you've had a chance to go through them. At full screen, you can definitely see the scratches and the imperfections. They're definitely there. There's no question about it.
They are, and I did see some of them, yes. Yeah. You're right.
But considering how much it's been handled and how it's on the road, what do you say, over 200 days a year it's on the road?
Over 200 days a year.
Yep, that cup is being handled and traveled. Now, granted, fans aren't allowed to handle the cup themselves. Like what we were allowed to do, when the cup was picked up off the pedestal and put on the ground, it was Howie that did it. It wasn't... anybody else, not even the people that work at, that were around the cup helping, with the moving the traffic through. It's the keeper of the cup only that is handling that cup. And so obviously he knows how to handle it. But when the players have it, when they win it and, they earn the right to lift it, they're handling it themselves. So, and that's probably when it gets most of the damage that it gets to. But as far as how the cup looked, this is the second time I've seen it. I saw it, of course, the first time in my life. I saw it back in 2011 at the NHL All-Star Game here in Raleigh. And, of course, that was kept in an indoor arena, indoor setting. And, I noticed right away it was much more brilliant because where it was this time around, it was essentially in a tent outside. Under bright sunlight, and the tent was white, so the lighting for the cup was about as perfect as you can get for in terms of taking photographs. The light outside was really, really bright because there wasn't a cloud in the sky, and the white tent or the white covering for it gave you almost optimal lighting conditions to take pictures. You know, it completely eliminated the shadows. So, yeah, great conditions for us to get awesome pictures. And if you if you look at the YouTube stream, find, or if you go to our YouTube page, and the shortcut to that is at thehockeynuts.com/YouTube. That'll take you right to our YouTube page. And if you watch the recording of this podcast, fast forward right to the part where we're talking about this towards the end of the show, and you'll see the pictures, or some of the best pictures that I took over the weekend, and you'll see them flash up on screen. Obviously, you can't see it if you're listening, but yeah, an amazing weekend to see everything that. If you get a chance to go, if it's in your city, by all means,
you want to
do it.
And that's right. And you're missing something if you don't go. You really are.
Yeah,
it was that well done.
And it doesn't take that long to go through. It's just a few little things. It's not a real big setup. You know, it only take a couple of hours of your time. That's it to go do this. Depending on how long you got to wait in line for the cup pictures, if you're going to bother to do that. But but yeah, it was a lot of fun. We had a good time. And I really enjoyed the stories that Howie said, because he's a Bruins fan. So
yeah, he is.
So
he is. His wife drives the Zamboni at the Tarrytown practice facility for the New York Rangers.
Yep.
So there was a connection on both sides there, Wayne.
Yep, there certainly was.
Yeah.
So and he told us that the year that the Bruins won the cup, he was the one accompanying the cup around to all the different Bruins players as they had their day with the cup over that summer. And he said he was like a kid in a candy store that summer.
Yeah.
He said getting to hang with all the Bruins players.
Yeah, he showed us pictures of Sedano Chara in Slovakia, but just beautiful stuff. Really something.
Yep. Real good time. So, all right. Well, let's go ahead and move on. And I think we're just about wrapped up, aren't we?
I think we are, Wayne. I think that I have nothing more, but that was really something. Very thankful for that day.
All right, so let's go ahead and close things up then for this week, because it's been another long one this week. Seems like we're getting longer, not shorter. All right, so next week, we're going to schedule the stream tentatively at around 6:30 Eastern Wednesday night, although we mentioned at the beginning of the show, because of the start of the playoffs at 7, we're probably going to want to try to get it done earlier than that, and hopefully I'll be able to get out of work soon enough to be able to do that, because next week we're going to go through our team-by-team preview, our playoff preview of all 16 teams and all 8 playoff series, because by then we'll know who's playing who and everything.
Right.
So we'll go through and give us the bulk of the show will be just a playoff preview, of the NHL playoffs. So I'm really looking forward to that. And then, of course, we'll also give us our initial picks for the individual awards that are based on regular season performance, which is most of them.
Right.
Really, it comes down to the Conn Smythe Trophy is really the only one that's determined by playoff performance. Everything else is determined by, in theory, regular season performance. And then, so that'll be next week's show is going to be all playoff all the time. And, of course, we'll get you caught up on everything that happens between now and then, including who won the Frozen Four and everything that goes along with that. So, once again, if you want to get in touch with us, you can get in touch with us. You can tweet me. I'm at WayneHalley9. Steve is at SBall504Man. You can email the show at feedback@thehockeynuts.com. You can reach us on our Facebook page at facebook.com/thehockeynuts, on our website at thehockeynuts.com. And our YouTube channel is the shortcut is thehockeynuts.com/YouTube. And that'll redirect you right to our YouTube page. You can find us on all of the major podcast websites or apps, whatever you want to call them, iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, Player.fm, Google Play Music, and then any other Android or Apple app that you may be using. You can also find us on thehockeywriters.com on their podcast channel, and it's a great site to go to for not just podcast content, but other hockey-related content as well. And again, you can support the show by using our affiliate links at Amazon, or go to our webpage at thehockeynauts.com. Click on the Amazon link or the Hockey Monkey link, depending on what you're buying. And any purchases you make will give us a little bit of a kickback, and it won't cost you anything extra for your purchase. So we appreciate those who have done that so far. And we appreciate in the future the consideration of you doing that to help us offset the cost of the recording of this podcast. And other than that, share the show wherever you see other hockey fans that you know, and subscribe to the show wherever you find us. And other than that, I don't have anything else.
I think we got it wrapped up this week, Wayne.
All right. So until next week and until the playoffs begin, we will go ahead and catch you later. We'll see you next week, Steve.
Have a good night now.
All right, you too.